You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. If you haven't watched our show before, I'm a plant pathologist and an arborist and a licensed pest control advisor, agricultural pest control advisor. I've got a long history in maintaining plant materials or, you know, taking care of various kinds of plants, particularly trees and shrubs, but really any kind of plant. And so this show really is about how to take care of your garden, the kind of plants we grow in our gardens in Southern California, all the things, all the issues. I like to say that we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. This is a live broadcast. You can call in at 1-800-339-1193 with questions about your garden, if you've had plant material do very poorly. We're here at the end of the summer season for your summer vegetable gardens. If you had problems with your summer vegetables, with your tomatoes, your eggplants, your beans, your corn, your squash, whatever it is, give us a call and we'll talk about your problems. Or if you've been successful, if you had a great year, call in. Let's talk about it. Let's celebrate your successes. Today we're going to talk about oaks, California native oaks, and additional some non-native oaks that are commonly grown in Southern California. But we always like to start our program off with upcoming events. And then we'll look at some mystery plants that you can call in and take a guess and tell us what you think our mystery plant is. I've got a couple interesting things that came through my laboratory during the week, and we'll take a look at those as well, and some things I collected in the field. But let's go to our upcoming events and see what you can put on your calendar. The plant information, stay informed on the latest landscaping and gardening topics with arboretum botanist Frank McDonough. Frank, of course, is a previous host of this show and a close friend of mine, October 1st, 1:30 to 3 p.m. At the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Baldwin in Arcadia. For more information about Frank's, I think this is really his monthly information session that he does for the volunteers. But of course, anyone's welcome to attend, but you can check it out at www.arboretum.org. and take a look at their calendar and see what they have for classes and upcoming events. There's a lot of things happening at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. In addition to that, we have Garden Talks with Lily Singer, which is also at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. Lily is a well-respected and well-known horticulturalist in Southern California. And she has a lecture series that she puts on Thursdays from 9:30 to 12:30. This is a paid class. She brings in really knowledgeable speakers to talk about various aspects of horticulture and gardening in Southern California. And you can contact them at 626-821-4623 for more information about the class and how much it costs to attend. In addition to that, we have All About Trees. This is also, at 26300 Crenshaw Boulevard in Palos Verdes Peninsula. I guess this is at the South Coast Botanic Garden on October 11th from 11 to 5. I'll learn about the remarkable tree diversity in Southern California. And in fact, nothing could be more true. We have one of the most remarkable urban forests and one of the highest diversity of trees that we grow in our gardens, as street trees, and in our parks. There's a lot of trees out there. Several hundred different species are commonly grown in Southern California. In addition to that, we have Las Aristas de Flores Flower. View more than 40 nature-inspired arrangements and miniatures. This will be at the Los Angeles County Arboretum at 301 North Baldwin. That is their address. For more information on this exhibit, give them a call at 626-821-4623. And that's our last event. And so let's take a look at our mystery plant today. This is a commonly grown plant in Southern California, mostly interior, but you could grow them outdoors in the spring and the summer and into the fall. They can't tolerate our winter chill. That would actually kill them. But let's take a look at here. Here's a couple of different ones. I'm going to put this plant to the side because that's not our mystery plant today. So you can see here, here's this group of flowers. And this is actually very common. You can find these in supermarkets. They've become very popular. Of course, this should be stuck up with a planting stake. It would look a little better. Now this one is a little bigger one that I've had for quite a few years. And the flower spike grew in this twisted, a little bit twisted, but that's fine with me. I'm not a stickler. But give us a call if you recognize this and take a guess what it is. We'll talk about how to grow them. And their needs, their cultural needs in order for them to rebloom, because you can buy these blooming almost any supermarket or nursery. They all carry them now. They've actually become quite inexpensive and they're a lot of fun to grow. Probably the easiest of this group of plants to grow. I won't give away the group quite yet, but if you know it, give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 and then we'll talk about how to grow these. And I'm just going to set this off to the side. Maybe just have it so a couple of the flowers come in and push this one down here. So let's take a look at something that came in during the week. My day job, I am a senior biologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. I run a plant diagnostic lab where I diagnose plant diseases and plant damage. And a lot of times you'll have damage on a plant or a tree or whatever the particular commodity might be that's coming in and out of LA County. But about half the time, it's not a biotic disease. It's not an infection. It's not a fungus or a virus or a bacteria that's infecting the plant, but rather it's cultural care. It can be salt burn. It could be herbicide drift. It could just be that it got too much full sun, or this heat wave we had last weekend where, and went into Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We were well into the hundreds throughout the interior valleys. That kind of heat will burn a lot of plants that normally can tolerate full sun. So we'll see a lot of sunburn damage in your gardens over this last week, but depending on the particular species you're talking about, it'll probably come back. I'm just gonna push this to the side because it's annoying me. Anyways, but we did have a sample that came in, and I'll tell you, one of the things our department, the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner, does, and we are a combined department, we're the Agricultural Commissioner and Weights and Measures Department, so that's half of our department is Weights and Measures, and you may not know what that means. What it means is we go out and our inspectors go out and make sure that any device used for weighing or measuring volume or weight that's used in commerce has to be inspected by our department, and it gets a sticker that says it's accurate. So if you buy a pound of meat at the supermarket, it weighs a pound, it doesn't weigh 0.9 pounds. You buy a gallon of gasoline at a gas station, you're getting a gallon, not less than a gallon. So our department enforces those regulations for weights and measures routinely. And unfortunately, we find people who do cheat the public by altering their scales or their weighing devices. The other half is agricultural regulation, and we do a lot of ag regulation, and we have dog teams that go to FedEx, the post office, UPS. They get there at the crack of dawn. In fact, well before dawn, actually. They get there about 4 o'clock in the morning when the trucks show up with all the boxes that are coming from out of state, shipments from Florida, from anywhere in the United States, and they come down the conveyor belts. Our dogs sniff those packages, and they are trained to sniff out agricultural products. So they'll find fruit, they'll find leaves, plants. They're not drug dogs. They probably would find marijuana if people were shipping that as well, because it's a plant, but they probably wouldn't find other types of drugs. They're not drug dogs. So they picked out a box earlier this week, and when our inspectors opened the box, it was full of wood. It had been shipped from Alabama. The wood was filled with wood borers, wood boring insects, and of course, they weren't adults. They were the larvae or the grubs. They're actually called flat-headed borers. And we found quite a few of them in the wood. We don't know what beetle that would actually turn into if it got if that package got delivered here in Southern California and then opened up and then somebody let that wood sit around for a few weeks, maybe a month or two, those grubs would have matured into beetles and flown off. That's how we get new beetles into Southern California, is people moving infested wood around, especially firewood. And we'll talk about that because that's really important, and I'm going to emphasize that. But what was also interesting was what was growing off this wood, because most of the wood was colonized by various fungi. A lot of the wood was so rotted you could just crush it. But this one interesting fungus was growing off of it. And if we could go to the overhead, I'll show you this fungus. Now, we're going to have a lecture on fungi later in the semester, and we'll talk more in depth about fungi and all the different groups of fungi. But we need to come over here. I don't know if we can. This is actually, that's something I want to talk about again in a minute, but I want to show my bowl. Usually we go right here in front of me. Can we get right here in front of me? Here we go. So I stuck this in water just a few minutes ago, and when I put it in, this is what it looked like. It was dry. You can see if I, you know, this is dry and brittle. This is not wet. And if you just dump it in water, it sucks up the water and it becomes gelatinous and rubbery. See this? And if you like Indonesian food, and if you've been to, there's an Indonesian restaurant in Pasadena, in Old Town, called Kuala Lumpur, that I've been to a few times over the years, you might find this in one of their dishes. This was growing off the end of one of the logs that we found being shipped in from Alabama, and of course it was confiscated and destroyed. But this is called wood ear. This is a jelly fungus. It's all rubbery and gelatinous. And it dries up and it gets very hard and dry. But all you have to do is drop it in some water. It'll pop right up, and it's all rubbery and gelatinous now. And the actual name of this fungus is called Auricula auricularia, and it is referred to as wood ear. The politically incorrect term was Jew's ear, but people don't call it that anymore. And that's a good thing, because a wood ear is far better. It looks like ears growing off of wood, but it is edible. I don't think I'll eat this one. I'll probably let it dry and put it into a collection. And here's another one. And this is equivalent to a mushroom. Of course, it's not a gilled mushroom, but it's very similar. This is the sexual reproductive structure. It's like a flower. The fungus itself is in the wood, decomposing the wood, getting its energy from the wood. And then it grows a reproductive structure that makes spores, and they're sexually derived spores, and so that is that's wood ear. So that's really fun to see, and you don't get to see it all that often. And I'm just going to grab something here to clean up this water here on the table. I see we have an email question from Mike. Let's take a look, see what he asked. He says, "I just moved here from Arizona, and had to stop at the California border where they asked me if I had any fruits or plants. What was that all about? I felt like I was coming through airport customs after an international overseas flight." Well, the California Department of Food and Agriculture has what we call border control stations. And when you go through one of them, and they are on the major interstates, they will ask you if you have any fruits or vegetables, because you're not allowed to bring certain fruits or vegetables into California from certain locations, particularly citrus is not allowed to be brought in from Florida. And if you bought oranges somewhere outside of California and you were bringing them in, we'd probably confiscate those, or at least the California Department of Food and Agriculture would confiscate those. So those are border stations. They are operated by the California Department of Food and Agriculture, and they are there to enforce the Food and Ag Code. And so say you had apples and they had been grown in Michigan. They're not allowed entry into California because of cedar apple rust, which is a quarantine disease. In the case of oranges coming from Florida, they've got citrus greening. They've got citrus canker. We had one tree with citrus greening. That was cut down about 2 years ago, and everyone's still petrified we're going to have more. But currently, we really don't have citrus greening in California. We don't have citrus canker, which is another devastating disease of citrus. The citrus industry is about $2 billion a year in California. And the purpose of these quarantines and regulations is to protect that industry. A lot of people work in that industry, packing plants, brokering citrus, shipping citrus all around the world. If we let infected material enter into California and that becomes established, then our growers will have to use more pesticides. It could even wipe them out, which is actually what is happening in Florida right now. They're being wiped out by citrus greening. It's killing, the last I heard, is 250,000 acres of citrus has been killed by citrus greening in Florida. So they're major issues for agriculture. California is the largest agricultural producing state in the United States. And we have to go to great lengths to protect our agricultural production. It also protects our natural environment because we have a lot of introduced exotic pests that are big problems right now today in California. And how'd they get here? People brought them in here. They brought them from other parts of the United States and they brought them from other countries. So yes, it's a little bit like coming through customs when you're coming from a foreign country. In that case, it's the USDA or customs inspections will be, if you have meat on you when you're coming in from a foreign country, they'll confiscate it. You're not allowed to bring meat products in. They don't know where it came from, how it was processed. It could have various problems with it that could then get spread to various, to cattle, chicken, or whatever the type of meat you're bringing. It might have serious problems with it. So that's what the Border Patrol, border checkpoints are for, is to enforce agricultural quarantines and prohibitions on bringing in certain agricultural products. So hopefully you're not going to smuggle it in and lie to them because that is a significant threat to our agriculture. You could bring in a new insect pest. You could bring in a new plant disease. You could bring in a new weed species. That would be a invasive and a problem. So it's all about protecting agriculture and protecting our natural environment. And we'll talk about, and you'll see how important that is, because we're going to talk about some new invasive pests that are devastating native oaks in California. Our talk today is on oaks. Now, before I go on and talk about oaks, let's talk about where you can read more about oaks. Of course, you could read about oaks on the internet. Wikipedia has a good section on oaks in general. The Sunset Western Garden Book has a nice section on oaks. The genus for oaks is Quercus. Let's look at my notes. It'll be in there. Let's go to the notes and talk about it. So I've got a number of books here I want to share with you before we get into the notes. But just to tell you, there are about 600 species of Quercus. We have about 18 native species of oaks, or Quercus, in California, but there are about 600 worldwide. We grow a lot of non-native oaks in California as well. It is the beech family or the Fabaceae, but let's take a look at a couple things. If you're into native plants and native oaks, Sierra Nevada Flora, this is by Whedon, a professor of plant genetics, Cornell. But this is Sierra Nevada Flora. Let me move this out of the way a little better and see if you can zero in on it. Maybe this is blocking it. I'm going to move our mystery plant. If you know our mystery plant, give us a call. But here is, this is a really nice book on the Sierra Nevada Flora. So if you hike in the Sierra Nevada in California and you want to know what plants you're seeing, this is an excellent book. Just take a quick look. You've got a lot of line drawings. And probably not a lot of color photographs, but these are keys. This is a key. This is the kind of book I like to get. Keys are books that have couplets. I know you can't read this on the screen, but it says A and double A. So it says fruit elongate, the main body at least three times as long as wide. Fruit definitely less than three times. So you get a couplet, A and double A, and you answer the question. And if you say yes here, then you go to B or double B. If you answer the question under double A, you go to B or double B under double A. And so you work through the key and you figure out what plant you have. So this is an excellent book if you want to identify plants that you find in the Sierra Nevada. It will also include oaks. Now, what else do we got? We have Sierra Nevada Tree Finder. Let's go to the overhead and take a look at this one. This is a really nice by Jim Park. And this is not quite as extensive. And it mostly is just descriptions. I don't think there's a key in here. Douglas fir, white fir, Pacific yew, but also a bunch of the oaks are in here. California buckeye, Oregon ash, valley oak, California black oak, big leaf maple. These are all native trees that you can find in our local mountains and also in the Sierra Nevada. Blue oak, I'll show you pictures of blue oak in a minute. Western sycamore, probably one of the most common trees you're going to find in Southern California. Oregon ash. So a nice book for if you want to go out. It's by Jim Park, Sierra Nevada Tree Identifier. So if you like to hike in the Sierras, that's a nice book. And then this is a Peterson Field Guide on Pacific States wildflowers. And this is a nice book if you're interested in wildflowers. More of a, it's not a key, there's no key in here, but you could go through here and look at a lot of these flowers. There's a lot of color drawings as well of flowers. And you might find something you want to grow in your own garden. Of course, everyone nowadays is interested in growing natives, especially natives that are very drought tolerant or things that are easy to grow. And so, you know, one of the things you're going to find in here, of course, is the California poppy. This is the time of year if you want to grow California poppy to seed them in. I'll go get a pack of California poppy seed at probably almost any garden center would sell California poppy seed. You want to clear the soil, maybe turn it and wet it, let it grow a few weeds for a week or two, turn it again. That'll, you know, you'll germinate all the other seeds that are in the soil, and then broadcast your California poppy seed and water it, and then let it come up, and you'll have a big display of California poppy in the early spring, probably February, March. You'll start seeing a lot of blooms, and they will reseed themselves in quite nicely. It is a native. It grows here naturally. And the interesting thing is that California poppies grow in disturbed soil. They don't grow in undisturbed soil. So they grow where animals walk a lot and kick up the soil, or so you see them. So they're fairly easy to grow and will give you a real display in the spring. Of course, they peter out rather quickly after about a month or 6 weeks. But let's talk about oaks. What is an oak? Of course, it can be a tree or a shrub. We think of oaks as trees, but there are shrub oaks or scrub oaks. And I just saw a really cool one during the week when I was up in Shadow Hills. There are about 600 species. They are in the beech family, the Fagaceae. The flowers are called catkins. They are produced in the spring. The fruit is a nut, and it is called an acorn. So if a tree makes an acorn, that actually makes it an oak. They are born in a cup-like structure known as a cupule or a cap. The live oaks are distinguished for being evergreen. So if you've heard of California Coast live oak, that is an evergreen oak. That is not a distinct taxonomic criteria. There are related oaks, some being deciduous and others being evergreen. And we'll talk about the three major groups of oaks in a minute. It is divided into two subgenera and a number of sections. I don't want to really get into that too much. There is a subgenus Quercus and a subgenus Psilobalanopsis. But most of you aren't interested in that. Those are the ring-cupped oaks of Eastern and Southeastern Asia. But let's talk about the three major groups of oaks in California. They are delineated by color. And so there are black oaks, there are white oaks, and there are golden oaks. The black oaks are also called red oaks. So if someone says a red oak, that is in the same group. Red oaks and black oaks are the same group. The ones that are members of the black oaks here in California, the California Coast live oak is a black oak. The black oak, the California black oak, is a black oak. The Santa Cruz oak, the Peninsular oak, and interior live oak. So now the white oaks. Let's talk about the white oaks. The white oaks are the California scrub oak, Mueller's oak, the blue oak, Nuttall scrub oak, which is Quercus demosa, the San Gabriel Mountains leather oak, which is Quercus dorata variety gabrielensis, Engelmann oak, Oregon oak, which is Quercus garyana, Tucker's oak, valley oak, Channel Island scrub oak, and shrub live oak. So you can see that's a pretty big group of white oaks. White oaks are the largest group of oaks in California. The golden oaks include Cedros Island oak, the Canyon live oak, Palmer's oak, and the island oak. So that's the smallest group. Let's talk about our California, the black oaks in California, see some pictures of them, see what they look like. And we'll start with the California Coast Live Oak. And we can bring up our first picture behind me. Now, before we go to full screen, I have a branch from the California Coast Live Oak. This is by far the most common oak you're going to see in Southern California. And let's go to the overhead, and I'll show you how you can recognize it quite easily. First off, it is a live oak, so it keeps its foliage year-round. In the spring, it will grow all new leaves and drop last year's leaves. So you get a big dumping of leaves in the spring, but if we just get one leaf off of here and turn this over, this one doesn't show it as nicely as some of the others. Let's get a different one. Come on. Get a leaf that'll cooperate. Let's see. Here we go. Take a look at this one. If we can get a little closer, what you can see is it's cupped-like. First off, the leaves are kind of cupped. And they have these teeth along the margin. If I can flatten it out a little bit. These little teeth right along the margin. And they're kind of, they're covered with little hairs on the back. It's a dark green. And it's a big tree, 20 to 70 feet in height with equal or greater spread. Look at this magnificent one behind me and bring that up full screen. We'll take a look at this California Coast Live Oak. Quercus agrifolia is the actual name. Agrifolia means water loving, although if you water in the summer, you'll probably kill them. Native to coastal and central and southern California. Smooth, dark gray bark, deeply fissured in old trees. Let's take a look at our next picture, and you'll see a little better depiction of the leaves, maybe than I showed you on the table. But you can see that the margin is toothed. See along here, these little teeth. And then here are the acorns. And the acorns, well, let's just talk about the leaves again for a minute. The leaves are oval, convex, stiff, leathery, dark green, with a toothed edge about 1 to 3 inches long. The acorn is conical, 3/4 to 1.5 inches long, matures in 1 year. And let me show you here I have a couple acorns, and I want to show you, I don't know if you're going to see this, but let's go to the overhead again and see if you can take a look at these. You can probably have to come in real closely. But these are acorns that I got off of California Coast Live Oak this week. They're conical, they're long and thin. They can be a little fatter, but if I spin this one, and I hope you can see it, there's a little tiny hole right there. This acorn has been colonized or parasitized by a wasp. And the wasp laid its egg in the oak. The egg hatched. A larva ate out the middle of this acorn and then emerged through this little hole. So if you try and grow this into an oak tree, it won't grow. So if you're interested in growing acorns or growing oaks from acorns, you don't want to bother with this because you know it's ruined. This one doesn't have any holes in it and very well would germinate and start a new tree. This is the cap or the cupule, and this is the acorn itself. These are long and conical. And as we saw in the picture, what the acorns look like as well. We can look at our next picture, which is number 3. And bring this up full screen. Get a good look at the foliage and the acorns. And you can see the acorn itself extends quite a way out of the cap. So it's pretty big. Let's see here. You can see that's pretty big acorn. Here are the leaves that are cupped with toothed margins. You can see these teeth right along here. So this is the California Coast Live Oak. It drops its old leaves in the spring. The flowers on all oaks are called catkins, and here are the catkins you will see on a California Coast Live Oak. They bloom in the spring. Let's bring this up full screen. And you can see new growth starting all over the place. And here are the old leaves from last year. And here are the catkins, which is a whole array of flowers. It's hard to see, but each one of these little like bumps is actually a flower. Those are the female flowers. The male catkins are quite a bit smaller. Now, our next oak we want to talk about is the California black oak. It is native from southern Oregon to southern California, so it has a tremendous distribution. A deciduous tree, even though it's a black oak, it's in the same group as the California coastline oak, or the same section within Quercus. It is deciduous. It will reach 30 to 80 feet in height and width. And let's bring up this picture behind me. And here is a magnificent, here's a couple of really nice California black oaks. We'll take a look at their foliage. It has a short trunk and a rounded crown. The leaves unfold soft pink in the spring and mature to a dark glossy green. And we can see those pictures in our next picture, which is number 6. There it is. Now this is the typical oak leaf, which is deeply lobed. So you can see these lobes like this. That's a typical oak leaf that people associate with oaks. You don't really think of oak leaves. When you think of an oak leaf, you don't think of the California coastline oak. You think of these deeply lobed leaves. Leaves are yellow or yellow-orange in the fall, so you'll get some fall color out of the deciduous oaks. Maybe this particular species is not quite as colorful as some of the others. The leaves, 4 to 10 inches long, 2.5 to 6 inches wide, so that's a pretty good-sized leaf. A 10-inch leaf would be quite large, with deep, sharply tapered lobes ending in points, and we looked at those. Now, the acorn is oblong or conical, 1 to 1.5 inches, matures in 2 years. That's interesting. A lot of oaks mature their acorns in 1 year, and a lot of them, many of them also, do it in 2 years. So you don't want to pick them. If you want to grow some acorns, if you want to pick some acorns and grow some oaks, make sure you're picking mature acorns. Now let's take a look at our next picture, which is number 7. And this is the black oak acorn. Bring this up full screen. You can see it's quite different from the acorn we saw on the California coastline oak. It's oblong. It can be a little more conical than this. Of course, there's variation, but it's not long and thin like on the California coastline oak or conical. It's more oblong. And here's the cup. And now if we take a look at our next picture, which is the bark on the California black oak is dark gray, furrowed, and checked. So you can see this checked and very dark gray. Now, on a California coastline oak, let me show you the bark on that because I have a piece of the bark with me. And you can see this is pretty much, let's go to the overhead and get a good look at this. This is a piece of oak bark. And you can see it's not quite so checked. This is typical of the California coastline oak. So you can see quite a difference between this bark and the bark you would see on a California black oak. And just before I don't forget, there here are our old acorns, just so I don't forget to mention it, these groups that I'm going to talk about black oaks or red oaks, same group, white oaks and golden oaks, they're real groups. They're not man-made groups. And why are they real? Well, because the members within the groups can hybridize, meaning a California coastline oak can cross with a California black oak, and you'll get acorns, and then you can take those acorns, and you can grow trees. You can grow a hybrid. You cannot cross a California black oak with a white oak or a golden oak. They won't cross. You will not get acorns, and you will not be able to grow a hybrid. So these groups are related genetically to each other close enough that they can cross and hybridize. And that's the whole, so that's why I say they're real. It's not like we're creating categories or creating a hierarchy, a taxonomy for these oaks that is not reflected by their biology. It's a real difference between the different groups. And it's based on them being able to hybridize with each other. So we talked about those. So then let's move on to our white oaks. This, of course, is the largest group of oaks in California. And probably one of the most famous of all the white oaks is the valley oak, Quercus lobata. Now, I might not have mentioned that the California black oak is Quercus kalagii. I want to give you those Latin names or the botanical names for each tree. And I want to emphasize, and I've said this before I go on much more, I really have to emphasize this. Plants get two names, or they get two parts of their name, of their Latin name. The first name, in this case, Quercus, which is the genus for oaks, that's the genus. And in that genus, you will have a number of species. And as I mentioned, there are about 600 species within the Quercus genus. Each species name is made up of the genus name and a specific epithet. A lot of times people just say, oh, that's agrifolia, that's the species. That's not the species, that's the specific epithet. That's the second part of the whole name. The whole name is Quercus agrifolia or Quercus calagii. That's the species name. The genus is Quercus, the species is Quercus calagii for California black oak. In this case, we're going to talk about white oak. We're going to talk about the valley oak, which is Quercus lobata. And this is what Thousand Oaks is named after. And you can go out and see these in the San Fernando Valley, all through Thousand Oaks. It is also referred to as the California white oak. It is deciduous, native to interior valleys, the Sierra foothills, and the coast ranges, so rather wide distribution. The valley oak tolerates cool, wet winters and hot, dry summers. Well, almost all our oaks really tolerate that. But requires abundant water for its thirsty root system. It is most abundant in rich, deep soils of valley floors below 600 meters in elevation. Let's take a look at our first picture of the California, or the valley oak. And bring that up. This is a valley oak in summer. And they are large, magnificent trees that can get quite large. The valley oak is widely distributed in California, Central Valley, the interior coast ranges south of the Eel River, and the transverse ranges from the Tehachapi Mountains to the San Fernando Valley. It is also present on Santa Cruz Island and Catalina Island. Some of the most picturesque stands are found in Sonoma Valley, Round Valley in Mendocino County, and the upper reaches of the Salinas River. So you can see these all the way from Southern California, all the way up into Northern California. Now, in the fall, they'll get ready to drop their leaves. So in the next month or so, they're going to start getting ready to drop their leaves, and they're going to change color. Let's bring this up. This is the valley oak in fall. And you can see it's starting to develop an orange or yellowish color to the leaves. And in winter, let's see if we have our winter picture, number 11. And you can see, this typical deciduous oak tree that you see in the winter without its leaves. It hasn't died, it's just dropped its leaves. Let's take a look at the leaves that you see on a valley oak. This is what they look like in the summer. Now, these are very deeply lobed. They are round lobed. They don't come to a point at the end. You can see here that they're round, not pointed like on the black oak. They are 3 to 4 inches long and 2 to 3 inches wide, dark green above, paler underside. And let's take a look at them in the fall. You can see how they start to develop their color. They kind of get yellows and reds and oranges. Let's take a look at their acorns and leaves again. This is our next picture. And here you can see the acorn. Here's the cupule or the cap, and here's the acorn itself. And then you can see there's variation in leaf. They can be, smaller or quite large. Nothing is absolutely uniform. The acorns are 1.5 to 2.5 inches. They're conical. They have a very warty, bowl-shaped cup, and they mature in 1 year. Now, our next oak is Quercus engelmanni, which is another white oak. The Engelmann oak, or also known as the Pasadena oak. So it is evergreen. Now, it's a white oak, it's evergreen. The valley oak is a white oak, it's deciduous. So you see, being deciduous or evergreen doesn't really affect its taxonomic, the hierarchy, how they're arranged, because you can cross an Engelmann oak with a valley oak and get a hybrid. So the Engelmann oak, which you find a small disjunct population in Pasadena, actually. There is a natural grove of Engelmann oak at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. It is a naturally occurring stand of Engelmann oak. But the most of the Engelmann oaks occur down in San Diego County. And so we refer to this as a disjunct distribution, which means you have the main body of the population in one area and a little clump of the same species, maybe some distance away, but not contiguous. They have a big, huge gap, maybe 100 miles or 150 miles, where there's none of them. And how that happens is it used to be that was contiguous, you know, a long time ago. I don't know if it was 10,000 years ago or 50,000 years ago, but it was a long time ago. All those oaks were growing in that area, but for some reason they died out in the middle, and you have a small group in up here in LA County, but most of them are down in San Diego County. So let's take a look at the Engelmann oak, which is number 15. So this is the actual, these are the acorns and the leaves. And they are actually quite blue. Here's bring that up full screen. And here is an Engelmann oak tree. It's a very large oak. You can see how big that trunk is. They get big. And they get to 40 to 50 feet tall and up to twice as wide. So it's typical kind of an oak size for the big trees. Native to Southern California, as I said, mostly in San Diego County with a population in Eastern Los Angeles County. It is called the Pasadena oak, the Engelmann oak, or the Mesa oak. The leaves are thick, leathery, and a dull bluish green. Let's take a look. We just saw those, the acorn and the leaves a moment ago. Let's bring that back up, bring it up full screen. And the leaves are oval or oblong to 2 inches long. And they are usually smooth edged, so you don't normally get teeth on them. You can see on the edge of this leaf, there's no teeth. Now the cap is, or the cupule, is quite warty or bumpy. And then it's not really conical. The acorns are oval to cylindrical, round tipped, 1 1/4 inches long, half enclosed in the warty cup. And you can see that if we bring that up full screen. Let's bring it up full screen again. There it is. So you can see that about half the acorn is exposed out of the cup. But that warty cup, the blue leaves, the smooth edge will tell you you have an Engelmann oak. The acorns mature in 1 year. And we've seen the oak leaves and the acorn. Now our next species is the blue oak. And this is a white oak. the kind of a paradox that you would call a tree a blue oak, when in fact it's in the white oak group, but that doesn't really matter. So the blue oak is Quercus douglasii, and you can see this magnificent specimen behind me in this photograph. Bring it up. Let's get a good look at it. So this is really, really, wouldn't you love to have that in your garden? It would be a signature tree. You don't see a lot of blue oaks being grown down here, but a few times. It is a deciduous oak, 30 to 75 feet tall with a 40 to 70 foot spread, native to the Central Valley and interior valleys of Southern California. So you will find a lot of these in Trinity and Shasta counties, south through the coast ranges and along the foothills of the Sierra Nevada, Santa Barbara County, northern Ventura County, and a very small part of northern Los Angeles County, you will actually find native California blue oaks, Quercus douglasii. Now we can take a look at the, it has light gray bark, shallowly checked in small squares, and the leaves are shallowly lobed. Let's take a look at the leaves, which is our next picture. Bring that up full screen. And you can see it is very blue. The foliage is quite blue, and the lobes are kind of shallow. They're not those really deeply lobed, you know, of course my drawing is horrible, but you get the idea. It's shallow lobes. You see here the lobes, and they're not very deep. They are oval, very bluish green, 1 1/2 to 4 inches long, and about 2 inches wide. In the fall, you will get pink, orange, yellow, colors. And let's take a look at number 19. This next one is actually the Oregon oak. We'll talk about that in a minute. Sorry, I don't have pictures of that. The acorns are egg-shaped, 0.75 to 1.25 inches long with sharp pointed tip, mature in 1 year. And we saw the blue oak leaves. Sorry, I don't have a picture of the acorns themselves. Now, at this point, I have some more native oaks to talk about, but I also wanted to talk about some of the threats to oaks in California. We're going to talk more about it as the show goes on, but before we go any farther into our list talking about all the native oaks, I want to show you a video clip about what's going on in the Cleveland National Forest. We have a new invasive beetle in the Cleveland National Forest that has killed tens of thousands of California coastal live oaks. It's called the gold spotted oak borer. It was almost certainly introduced from firewood that was brought in from Arizona. The gold spotted oak borer naturally occurs in Arizona, but showed up in the Cleveland National Forest some time ago. It's a little beetle. It lays its eggs in the trunk of the tree. They hatch, the grubs or the larvae come out and start feeding on the tree, and then you get a whole bunch of them in the tree and it kills the tree. So let's take a look at this video clip. It is invasive beetle destroys 80,000 oak trees and counting. So this is a major pest of oaks here in Southern California, particularly the California coast live oak. Luckily it hasn't spread too much. It's mostly in the Cleveland National Forest at this point. Let's take a look at this video clip.
This isn't the sound you expect to hear in the serenity of the San Diego County mountains, but these workers, armed with chainsaws, are racing against an invasive creature on a path of destruction. The gold-spotted oak borer beetle has killed 80,000 oak trees in the county over the last decade. The Cleveland National Forest has taken the brunt of the massive die-off.
This is probably the worst invasive insect problem that these oak trees have ever experienced. And as we can see with the tens of thousands of dead oak trees, the problem is only going to get worse over time.
Mark Hoddle is a biological control specialist at UC Riverside.
Oh, two. Look at that. Bonus.
He says the trees are ultimately killed after the beetles burrow their eggs in the underside of the bark and the hatched larvae eat away at the tree.
So you can see how extensive that is.
So when you have hundreds or sometimes possibly thousands of these beetle larvae feeding in these trees that are dying around us, they're essentially cutting the tubes that move the nutrients up and down the tree, and the tree ends up ultimately starving because these tubes have been cut and they can't get their food or water anymore.
The infested trees typically die within 3 to 5 years, a rapid mortality for 150-year-old oaks. The beetle was first discovered in San Diego County in about 2004. Hoddle says it likely came here in a bundle of firewood from its native home in Arizona. There, the beetle is hardly visible because its predators keep it in check.
And here in California, where the climate's great, you know, there's tens of thousands of oak trees for it to attack and no natural enemies, boom, the populations have exploded, and we're seeing the consequences of that now.
Roger Kovalt is supervising park ranger at Heisey Park and Campgrounds near Julian, the epicenter of the invasion. His crew has cut down 800 dead trees so far, with hundreds more to go.
The entrance drainage used to have a very full canopy of oak. Now most of the trees are down and the light shines through. It's quite sad. We're losing this canopy and campers miss it.
Kovalt says the onslaught of dead trees has created hazardous conditions for park visitors and campers. Trails and campgrounds are often closed because of unstable trees.
Well, safety is a big issue. They die, they fall, and we don't want them to hurt the public. You also have an increased fire danger with the dried out tree, more likely to burn if a fire comes.
The oak borer has a single-generation life cycle and lives for 1 year, but it's capable of producing more than 100 eggs, with 70 to 80% hatching and producing larvae.
Thousands of acres of oak forests in San Diego County face an ecosystem collapse if these beetles can't be contained. The acorns are essential for deer and rodents. Woodpeckers store their nuts in these trees, and they're home to dozens of birds.
And areas that are shaded by these oak trees often hold water and keep these areas damp. And in those areas, we find unique plant and animal species that can only live in these moisted areas underneath the shade of these giant oak trees. And all that's in peril now as these oaks die.
Hoddle says invasive species are an accelerating problem in Southern California. Exotic insects are becoming established in the region an average of one every 40 days. He says population growth, tourism, and increasing trade are to blame.
So some recent examples, in addition to the gold-spotted oak borer, are brown widows, which many people are now finding in their backyards. We have problems in our citrus orchards now with Asian citrus psyllid, which is native to the Indian subcontinent in Southeast Asia. We have problems with something called the spotted wing Drosophila, which is a very small fly which now attacks our blueberries, raspberries, and blackberries.
Hoddle is on a mission to track down the gold-spotted oak borer's enemy before it decimates oak forests all the way to Oregon and beyond. He's specifically looking for a parasite that attacks the beetle's eggs and larvae.
We've begun those surveys in southern Arizona. We're expecting that this process may take at least 5 years before we can get natural enemies into California to release against the gold-spotted oak borer.
Hoddle says the question is, in 5 years, will there be any oak trees left to save? Susan Murphy, KPBS News.
Well, yeah, there'll still be some oak trees left in 5 years. Maybe not enough. So what happens is all these oak trees start dying in these national forests where people camp. So how did it get there? Well, somebody brought firewood from Arizona and they brought it to the Cleveland National Forest. And maybe they didn't burn it all. And they left it sitting next to their, you know, the campground right there. And then after a few months, the beetles came out of the firewood and flew off and started colonizing the oaks in that area. So the take-home message is don't move firewood. It's not just this particular insect and this species that we're talking about, not just California coast live oak and not just the gold-spotted oak borer. You can move all sorts of wood-boring beetles in firewood. So the catchphrase that you're going to see from a lot of the agencies and people who work on these invasive pests is burn it where you bought it. So if you're going up to the Sierras and you're going to go camping, don't bring firewood from Southern California up to the Sierra Mountains. Go up to the Sierras and buy some local firewood up there. And we have a question real quick before they erase it. Is this why the fires are so bad in San Diego area, the Silverado fire? Well, this is going to make the fires much, much worse. And if you have 80,000 dead trees, you can imagine the fire hazard from that. It's just phenomenal. But we also have the drought that's been going on for 2 years, a severe drought. So we've got very, very dry chaparral, which can burn quite easily on its own. We don't need dead trees to have a fire hazard. So we've got a major fire hazard in the chaparral every year. The plants are very dry. They are fire adapted. Their seeds are fire adapted. The chaparral is supposed to burn. But when you put on top of that, you know, tens of thousands of dead trees, well, then the fire hazard is that much greater. And if it's in the campground areas where people like to camp, well, when those fires come and people get trapped, we could lose lives. We could have homes burned down, and we see it. We're going into the fire season right now. So, this makes the fire much worse, much hotter. The drought is a big problem. The chaparral naturally burns, but now we got all these dead trees. So let's go on and talk a little bit more about. I guess we'll stay with this camera. Let's talk about some more of the species. And let's see if our next species. Let's talk about the Oregon oak, which is Quercus garyana. This is a wonderful species. And this is called the Gary oak, deciduous tree, 40 to 90 feet tall with a 30 to 60 foot spread, native from British Columbia to the California transverse ranges. The bark is gray. The branches often twisted. And let me see what kind of picture we have. We have the Oregon oak leaves here. Let's bring that up full screen. And you can see what these leaves look like on the Oregon oak. So here you go. rather round lobed, not too deep, much deeper than you saw on the California blue oak, which was Quercus douglasii. So the leaves are leathery, 3 to 6 inches long, oval, with rounded lobes, glossy, dark green above, and rusty or downy beneath. Reddish brown in the fall. In the fall, they're going to drop their leaves, and the leaves will turn a reddish brown. And the acorns are globular, edible, 1.25 inches long, bulging from small, scaled, covered cup, mature in 1 year. Let's take a look at number 21. Bring those up full screen. And you can see this particular acorn, looking very apple-like to me. Not really a warty cup, but you can see these little bumps, slightly warty. And no round tip. And here are the leaves again. And so those are all the white oaks we've got to talk about today. And the next are what we call the golden oaks. And there is Quercus chrysolepis, and that is the canyon live oak. And it is an evergreen tree, 20 to 60 feet tall and wide, native to foothills and desert mountains from southwest Oregon to Baja California. So it has a tremendous distribution. The bark is smooth and whitish when young, checked and gray when old. And if we bring this up, this tree has a really remarkable characteristic that it can have leaves that are very toothed. You see all these teeth right along here. Or it can have leaves like this next picture, number 23, where there's only one or two teeth, or there's really no teeth and the edge is smooth. So you can have this branch on the tree, or you could have the other branch right next to it. So the leaf is, if you see that, that's actually a characteristic. If you see toothed leaves, and then on this branch over here, you have smoothed edge leaves, you're almost certainly looking at chrysolepis is the canyon live oak. Let's take a look, and we saw the leaves. Now let's take a look at the acorns, because this is why golden oaks are called golden oaks. Let's bring this up full screen. And you can see, here's the acorn. It is oblong, sharp-tipped, 2 inches long, enclosed to 2/3 in the turban-like cap covered with golden fuzz. And that's the most important thing, the golden fuzz. You see that the cup is very golden yellow. And that's why they're called golden oaks. All the members of the golden oaks have these type of caps or cupules. It is the most widely distributed and variable of California oaks. Highly variable. And we've got, we've seen all our photos of it. Now there's a group of oaks called the scrub oaks. And there's Quercus dorata. And they are small shrubs. Go ahead and bring that up full screen. And you can see, this is really a shrub, not really a tree, and could be easily 50 to 100 years old, and is called Quercus dorata. Now, if we take a close look at number 26, we'll see the leaves of Quercus dorata. And they have teeth on the edges. Now there's a couple other scrub oaks. This isn't the only one. Dorata, there's also Quercus demosa. But we're gonna go to a station break and bring you some announcements from the university. And when we come back, we'll talk more about oaks, and I'll show you a few more interesting things about oak trees. Until then, stay tuned and listen to these wonderful announcements from the university.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
I'm Timothy Hudson, member of the Drug and Alcohol Counselor Program faculty at California State University, Dominguez Hills. Abuse of tobacco, alcohol, and illicit drugs is costly to our nation, exacting over $600 billion annually in costs related to crime, lost work productivity, and health care. What's often not talked about is the emotional and mental costs that people abusing substances do to themselves and those around them. I'd like to invite you to join us for a series of live interactive discussions about addiction in America, what it looks like, how it can be successfully treated, and how you can pursue a career in counseling. Join us each week for information, encouragement, and solutions that can change the future for you and those around you. We look forward to seeing you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Maria Rosales. I'm a senior at California State University Dominguez Hills. I'm majoring in Criminal Justice Administration. The reason why I decided to come to this campus was for its great faculty, great location, and friendly environment.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era. On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first. Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. This is the live broadcast garden show where we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. So if you want to call in with a question, give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. You can also email us, and we'll have that email up. It's right there on the screen for you. AskDHTVLive@gmail.com. Send us an email. Give us a call. If you had a problem with your garden, or if you're having an ongoing problem, if you're interested in trees, if you're interested in what's wrong with your shrubs, you want to grow a drought-tolerant garden, and you want to get rid of your lawn, call in. I'll tell you how to do that. And I see we have a caller, so let's go to our first caller and see what her question is, or their question is. Terry, you're from Pasadena. You're on the air.
Yes, I have a question about my oak tree. I wanted to know what time of year should I prune my oak tree, and how often should I prune it?
Okay, well, if you're calling from Pasadena, I'm going to kind of guess that you're probably pruning California coast live oak. That's the most common oak in Pasadena. You perhaps have an Engelmann oak, a Quercus Engelmanni. But regardless, native oaks are dormant in the summer months. Generally speaking, you want to prune trees when they're dormant. So the best time to prune oaks is usually during the summer and into the fall. Often people prune them in the fall. If you prune them a little too much in the summer, you might let a little sun in. If you're growing any oak-compatible plants underneath the canopy and we get really, really high temperatures, then you may burn some of the plant materials you have under your oak. Of course, you should only grow oak-compatible plants under your tree, things that don't need a lot of water. So you should avoid growing things like azaleas or ferns or things you got to water every week or several times a week, and especially a lawn is the worst thing to put under an oak. So the summer months and into the fall are the best time to prune. One of the reasons for that is there is a powdery mildew that can infect California coast live oak. And it gets worse if you prune right before the spring flush. So if you prune in January or February, you'll often actually make that powdery mildew problem worse. And I've seen powdery mildew problems get really bad on trees that were badly damaged in windstorms or are severely pruned because people don't know how to prune. And since you're asking about pruning oaks, let me just briefly comment on how to prune trees in general, and particularly oaks. Never wound the trunk. Prune to enhance the natural form. Do not remove any branches over 2 inches unless you have a reason. So avoid wounds over 2 inches. You can move the deadwood any time of the year, but mostly you deadwood the trees. The general recommendation for pruning any trees is to not remove more than 25% of the canopy in a single pruning. And a lot of arborists recommend you do not remove more than 10% of the foliage on oaks when you prune them. They reduce that on oaks. It's believed that oaks are even more sensitive to severe pruning than other species of trees. So prune them in the summer and the fall. Avoid severe pruning. Avoid wounds over 2 inches. And prune to enhance its natural form. So don't top the tree. And do not let anyone climb your tree with spikes or poke holes in the trunk of the tree. I will have a lecture on how to prune later in the semester, but I hope that answered most of your question.
Yeah, it did. Well, thank you so much. I will follow those directions.
Okay. Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the show. So, we'll talk about that in the coming weeks. The pruning season is approaching. In fact, this is a good time to prune your oaks right now because we're in the late summer. And next summer will be over and it will be fall very soon. And a lot of our trees are deciduous, and that's the best time to prune them. I think you can see the form of the tree much better when the leaves are all gone, and you can see how you want to adjust that. But beware that you're going to see a very bad pruning all over the place, which is severe pruning. When you are topping trees, trying to make a 75-foot tree down to 50 feet or even lower, that's really bad for trees. Nothing you can do worse. I see we have another phone call. Let's go to our next caller. Nicholas, calling from West LA, you're on the air. Do we lose Nicholas, or is he still there?
Hi, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Go right ahead.
Oh, great. Yeah, I'm here in West LA. I live at the VA complex.
Okay.
And we have very hard adobe that has seldom been planted or worked. And as soon as we start planting and watering, we get an onslaught of gophers that makes it almost impossible to keep any plants in the ground.
Oh, so you've got a gopher problem.
Yeah.
Well, gophers are difficult to deal with, as are almost all what we refer to as vertebrate pests. So birds, gophers, rabbits, deer, all of those are very difficult. They really present a different problem compared to insects or plant diseases. What you can do is you could plant on a little mound, and underneath the mound you can put down chicken wire or some kind of screen. I don't know that that's going to be a great idea for trees. That works really well for shrubs and vegetables. The other thing is to poison them and try and get after the population. You have to dig down to the lower tunnel. The surface tunnels that you see from gophers, they don't return to those tunnels. The ones that are only like 6 inches to 12 inches deep, they're not going to return to those tunnels. They've got tunnels down about 2 feet that are permanent tunnels that they go back and forth in. You've got to dig down to one of those tunnels and either put traps in there or put poison in there. Now, the other thing is to figure out what species. Well, it's gophers. I'm thinking of ground squirrels. That's a whole different issue. But the gophers are really, really hard. So they're eating your roots, aren't they? You there, Nicholas?
Yeah. So yeah, they go right under the plants, and they pull them down into the hole.
What size of trees are you planting?
Well, I'm planting a garden.
Oh, this is in your home. This is...
No, this is at the VA complex. I live in a home for disabled vets.
Oh, okay.
And we have room outside to plant.
But so you're not really talking about growing trees. You're talking, what kind of plants are you referring to specifically?
Well, I'm thinking of doing a garden. I'd like to have a multi-tiered garden with some plants providing shade, you know, for the plants below. And so I'm planting tree kale, beans, different types of beans, and different types of leafy vegetables, lettuce.
Okay, well then what I mentioned is actually very effective, is you dig a shallow hole, maybe down about 6 to 12 inches. 12 isn't all that shallow. And then you line that with chicken wire, and you can fold the chicken wire in half, or you can get a wire mesh. And then you make a mound above that, and you plant in the mound. That's very effective at preventing the gophers from getting to the roots. And that's what I had to do when I had a large vegetable garden at the community garden plot at UC Riverside. And we had so many gophers. We had probably the same experience you're having. Lots and lots of gophers. And they would come, and you'd have a big squash plant, and it would be looking fabulous, and with a little squash on it. And you come back the next day, the whole thing's wilted and collapsed, and the gophers have come up and eaten all the roots.
Yeah.
So using this wire technique where you line your hole like this with either chicken wire, and I used to fold the chicken wire over so I'd get a little smaller hole, but you can get various kinds of screen or chicken wire, and that will protect your vegetables, especially, you know, the leaf. It really doesn't matter. Tomato, lettuce, all that kind of stuff. Now, are you planting beans right now?
I'm thinking of planting some beans, yeah.
Okay,
it's
too late to plant beans. Beans are a summer crop. You want to grow peas now. The things you can grow this, because we're going into the winter. So this would be a winter garden. If you're planting, and this is the time to start your winter garden, is because we're still a little warm, and the soils are warm, and if you get the plants in right now in the next 2 to 4 weeks, you'll get a good start before we get a little cold. And if you plant in November or December, your plants will tend to kind of sit there a little bit, not grow too much until we warm up as we approach spring. So the things you can grow right now are all your head, anything that heads, a head lettuce, cabbage, all the coal crops. So you can grow a broccoli, cauliflower, you can grow Brussels sprouts. These are all spinach. Those are all grown in the winter. Beans aren't going to do well. It's going to get too cold and the days are going to be too short. Beans you plant in the spring and grow in the summer. So it's a little late for beans, but you can grow peas. You can grow snap peas. You can grow regular peas and all the lettuce. Lettuce does really well and cilantro does really well in the winter. So just a caveat there that you might do okay with beans, especially if you did bush beans. But don't expect them to last all the way into February or something, because it's really, winter is not a good time to grow beans, but it's a great time to grow peas.
Well, I have some fava that I've saved.
I'd save them until March. I'd plant those in March.
Okay, I'll do that.
Because in general, all the beans are grown in spring and summer. You plant them in the spring and you grow them through the summer months. And then once we get into the fall, you tear all that stuff out and you plant peas, lettuce, cabbage.
I got to hit the leafy vegetables and the brassicas.
Huh? Yeah, and the brassicas. That's right. And it's a great time to grow lettuce. Lettuce is, you can have a great crop of all the different kinds of lettuce we grow in California. And commercially, we grow about 250 different kinds of lettuce in California, or more actually. So, but put down that if you had a problem with gophers, and for me, I was not good at trapping them. My neighbor in my community garden plot was really good at it. He trapped a bunch, and every time I trapped, I didn't get any. So I just put everything on screen. I dug a little hole and lined it with screen, and that kept them away, and it worked really well.
Yeah, I like your idea, because I'm not that happy to go killing these things.
Well, and tell you the truth, you're only, when you trap and you poison, you're only kind of suppressing the population a little bit.
Right.
And you're never going to get rid of them. So for a vegetable garden, that works really well. For shrubs, it works pretty good. But the problem with trees, planting trees on screen, is it can interfere with the roots later on when the tree gets older.
How do I take care of the gophers if I want to do trees?
Well, you might pick trees that they're going to leave alone. They really like fruit trees. They would probably leave some, they go after citrus like crazy. I'd have to check and see if I have a source on trees that they might leave alone. They may not like red buds. That would be a nice tree. I'd have to check on that. I'm not sure which trees are. I know the fruit trees, they love those. But they'll probably leave some of our other tree species alone, like ginkgo, ficus, eucalyptus. But I'd have to go back and try and find a source on trees resistant to gophers.
Well, I got enough to get started with, actually.
Oh, yeah, there's plenty to grow other than some big trees. And I know there's that whole facility there is dedicated to our veterans. And there's a big discussion about planting, what kind of trees to grow there and how to make the environment better for you guys. So good luck with your vegetables. And give me a call. Let me know how it works out. I see we have an email from Beth. Let me just take a sip of water. It says, my oak trees are infested by ants. Can I anticipate any problem with the health of the trees in my yard? No. Ants are not a real tree pest. Now, there's a couple different ants you might see in your tree. You might have Argentine ant going up in your tree, which are the small black ants. They're going up there probably looking for honeydew from sucking insects. The other one, and I think it's more likely you've got this one, is called the velvet tree ant. And it is not pure black. It is black and red. And if you look at it closely, you'll see it looks kind of furry. That's why they call it velvet. It's got a lot of hairs all over it that make it look velvety. They'll bite you, or they'll sting you, I should say. Although they're not aggressive. You know, I've gotten them on me and not gotten any stings at all, but I've seen them a lot going up and down the trunks of trees. Excuse me. So for Beth, let me just talk about ants a little bit more. The way you control ants was by baiting them with something that they will collect and then share with the entire colony, because ants have what we call a collective stomach. The workers are out collecting food, they bring it back and share it with the whole colony. So my favorite, for the Argentine ants, I just use sugar water and boric acid. I'm not sure that the velvet ants would be attracted to that. I know that in some of the parks, the people who run parks, you know, parks and rec departments of various cities and counties, they don't like those ants because they can sting people, and they will if you get, you know, if you disturb them and really give them a reason to. And they'll spray for them, and they'll use maybe a pyrethrin or a pyrethroid. You could kill them with just soapy water. In fact, if you wanted to just suppress that population, just spray your tree with soapy water. It'll kill all the ants you hit. It's not going to get rid of the whole colony, but it will knock them down. But ants are not a pest of oak. And so we've got a phone call and another email. Let's go to our phone call first, and then we'll go to Dan with his email. Our next caller is Susie calling from North Hollywood. You're on the air. Go ahead,
Susie. You can hear me.
I can hear you.
Okay. I have a 25 to 30 foot ficus benjamina growing in my neighbor's yard on the property line on the other side of my wall. It's having huge leaf drop right now. I'm assuming that's from the drought. The leaves are turning brown and then yellow and dropping like crazy. This started last week. It's defoliating, basically.
Okay.
Now, this tree has not gotten any water, I come to find out, when I spoke to the neighbor, who isn't exactly a green person, and come to find out this tree's been given no water for at least 2 years.
Yeah. So there's no air. What else is growing around it? She doesn't have an automated system or a lawn?
No. It's in a driveway, and actually the fellow has been stacking things on top of the root zone. Bricks and wood, and so it's gotten nothing. They have watered not a drop.
Well,
whatever this tree has had in the past has been solely dependent on the non-existent rain.
Yeah, and that's what we're seeing pretty consistently throughout Southern California, is a lot of these trees that did quite well with summer, with a winter rainfall, are now showing severe signs of drought stress.
Right. So, now, this is a ficus. I mean, I'm pretty familiar with that family.
Yeah.
And they seem to be pretty tough, you know, and possibly will come back. But there's lots of twiggy growth. I'm wondering, would it be wise for me to try to trim it back at this time of the year? Would that be good, maybe, so that it doesn't have so much leaf to support?
Well, the most important thing would be to try and water it.
Well, if it were mine, I would. There's no way that I can water it from my property.
Is it paved on your side of the property?
It's paved on my side of the property, although I have been trying to slow. I mean, it's totally, I've got brick walkway on my side of the wall, and this is on the other side of the wall, on the neighbor's side. He's done the same thing. I have a couple of old Pittosporum undulatums, and he has put a tent up on his side of the wall, which means I can only irrigate them from my property, which is a brick patio with a flower, maybe a 8-foot flower bed, which I deeply soak. But those trees are also suffering from no water at all from on his side.
Well, but if you're watering them on your side, that'll probably be sufficient, especially if you deep water them once a month.
Deep watering. There's a lot of dead growth inside. They
well,
do suffer. Those
two,
trees
yeah,
suffer
there's
from
two things
scale.
To tell you about. One, of course, you need to water that ficus benjamina. But
yeah.
We also have a new white fly that's attacking ficus benjamina and ficus microcarpa.
Haven't seen it, thank God.
Well, it's very hard to see until you start getting a lot of white flies flying all over.
Haven't seen any. I'm an avid gardener. I would have noticed.
But
they can
defoliate ficus. And really, a lot of people are calling up telling me they're benjaminas and their microcarpas are defoliating, and it's this white fly. And if you just look at the leaf, the back of the leaf, it's very hard to see the white fly. They're almost clear. So they're hard to spot until you get a big hatch out and you get a lot of flies flying around.
Yeah, haven't seen that, but I just think this is from lack of water. I do.
Well, it very likely is. I don't know if you can sneak a hose over the wall in the middle of the night.
I could do that. Do you think I should sprinkle some gypsum? I mean, his soil is so fallow over there. I mean, it's just
Well, it just
off.
Needs water. It just
Right, exactly. But should I have him work some gypsum in, maybe?
Well, gypsum is beneficial for a variety of reasons, but that's, you need water. The gypsum's
water
not going to save it if you don't water it. The gypsum can be beneficial, and you can spread it on the surface of the soil and scratch it in. It's particularly good for citrus, avocado, and other fruit trees. It's probably not going to be particularly great. It's not going to hurt anything, and it's good to have high calcium levels in the soil. Gypsum
How about water in, that chemical, whatever that is, that you can put in the water to help it percolate down?
Oh, like a penetrating agent.
Yeah, that's what
I'm
thinking.
The way I would do it is I would, if you can, is set a hose right next to the tree and have it just trickle. And have it trickle for about an hour, and then keep moving it around the tree.
Well, that's what I can try my best, but I have a 6-foot wall. I mean, I've been putting the hose over, and I'm not on the other side of the wall where this tree is.
Yeah.
So
that's
the
tough. It's his tree,
off.
and it's. But if you can, say let's save the tree and put a
right.
hose there and let it trickle. You need to, if you understand deep water, and you need to let it trickle for a long time. And you can move it around like every hour, and then the goal is to soak the soil to a depth of about 3 feet.
Exactly.
And so if you can do that, the tree may recover. But I would look carefully at those leaves and see if you can see that white fly.
If
you've got the white fly, then you need to control that. Now, let's talk about your Pittosporum undulatum problem, too.
Yeah.
Because over the last 5 to 10 years, there's been a big die-off of Pittosporum undulatum, which is, of course, the common name is Victorian box.
I know.
And no one knows why. And I have received a lot of samples into my lab, and I've sent them up to the state lab in Sacramento, and they don't test positive for scorch, which everyone thought this was going to be a new scorch host. Scorch is killing liquid ambers and olives and purple leaf plum and crepe myrtle, and of course, oleanders. That dates back to
yeah.
the 1990s. So everyone thought this was going to be a new scorch host, Pittosporum undulatum, but they don't test for that. I was just actually cutting some down yesterday with my son, and I found some cankers. So I don't know if this is going to be a canker disease in the Pittosporum, but they are dying quite extensively throughout West LA, and even people are calling me from Downey and places like that saying their pits are dying. And in the Tabiras, the shrub, is not dying. So it's a little confusing as to what's killing them. No one's figured it out yet.
Right. These are old, they're big, and they have had problems for many, many years with scale, and I have been using the Drench from Bayer for the past few years, and that has really helped control that. That's done a great job with the scale.
The Bayer Advanced Tree and Shrub.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you see the white fly on that Benjamina, you can treat it with the same product.
Okay. Yeah, if I could get to it, that would be a wonderful thing. That's my main problem with the Benjamina. So
convince your neighbor that it's worth saving his tree, and it's not that much water. Once a month, you just deep soak the tree. And
I've
then,
been trying, and I'll continue to try. But on the Pittosporum, it seems to be dying from the inside.
Yeah,
There's new growth, but dying from the inside. A lot of dead branches. Just keep trimming those out?
Well, once they're dead, you can trim out the dead branches. The thing to try on the Pittosporum is, and again, if this isn't on your property, it's hard to do.
No, these are on my property.
Oh, okay. Well, what you can do is you can apply a fertilizer mycorrhizae mix.
Okay.
You drill holes in the soil,
right.
About an inch in diameter, about 8 inches deep, maybe as deep as 10, and about 1 to 2 feet, all underneath the canopy of the trees. And then you put in the fertilizer mycorrhizae mix. And there's the one I bought yesterday, actually, or I bought it Friday, is from Grow Power. There's all another one called BioStart. Dr. Earth is the same thing. That's kind of an expensive way to buy it. You can get it cheaper if you get it at a landscape supply location rather than go to a retail nursery.
Okay.
But you put those about every 1 to 2 feet of the holes, fill it in, water it in real good. And then you could also treat the tree with something that usually is used for controlling phytophthora diseases. is called Agrifos, or you could get one of the phosphorus acid fertilizers like Fosgard from JH Biotech, which is much cheaper way to buy it. It's the same stuff. And people have reported from West LA particularly, some of the tree people I know out there, said that they've seen a good growth response from treating with phosphorus acid. And you can get Agrifos, which is the actual registered fungicide for controlling phytophthora diseases, or you could go get phosphorus acid fertilizers. Those aren't sold in nurseries. You'll have to contact JH Biotech in Ventura and buy it directly from them. And you could try that. Now, if you're gonna treat your Pittosporum undulatum, I would treat them once a month with a phosphorus acid product. You could put the mycorrhizae fertilizer mix on now, or you could wait till February, because spring is the best time to apply that, but you could do it now. Now let's go to our email from Dan. Are my oaks more likely to get diseased because of the drought and excessive heat? Yes, they are more likely to get damaged because of severe drought if you're not irrigating them. And if we don't get rain in the winter, if we go through another dry winter, you need to irrigate once a month, and you need to give them 3 to 4 inches of water. Now, if you can't measure your inches, if you have sprinklers, you can put cups out, and you can run the sprinkler until you've applied 3 inches of water. Now, you don't want to apply faster than about a half an inch an hour. Unfortunately, lawn sprinklers tend to apply at about 2 inches an hour. That's a big problem. And so you want to have a long, slow, deep soak, and you would do that once a month. If we don't get any rain in December, and it doesn't look like we're getting rain in the next few weeks, like once we get to the end of December, go ahead and water them. If the same thing happens in January, if we don't get rain, give them a deep soak in January. Give them a deep soak in February. You can also deep soak them in March and April. Now, a lot of times you might go through the whole winter and realize at the end of the winter, maybe February, that we haven't gotten any rain, because you keep hoping we're going to get it, and it doesn't come. So then deep water them in March, April, May. You could even water them one more time in June, but that's kind of the cutoff. If you've deep watered them 4 times in the spring, 4 months, then you don't need to water them at all, and you should not water them at all in July, August, September, October. You might want to go ahead and water them. Your trees will perform better in the landscape if you deep water them once a month. So you could go ahead and deep water them once in November, but then wait and see if we get our winter rains. And I'm hoping, and everyone's hoping, that we get a good wet winter. So what happens when they're drought stressed? Well, I brought in an example of exactly what happens when they're drought stressed. I showed you this piece of bark here, and this is California coast live oak. And I showed it to you just a minute ago just to show you what the bark looked like. Well, let's look at the other side and why do I have this piece at all? Come on to the overhead, and I'm going to show you another. I've got two pieces of bark from California coast live oak. Actually, one of these is actually from Quercus engelmanni. This one is California coast live oak. And I got this out of a park in La Crescenta, where a number of the oaks have died. And so once the trees get drought stressed, they get attacked by various wood borers. Now this one got attacked by the Nautilus wood borer. And you can see in here this frass. See this that I'm poking out? This is frass. And I see here, what are the holes at the bottom? Well, all these grooves in here, and I don't know if it shows it real good, but you can see in here, you see this? It's kind of packed in here. And this is what you call frass. You see, I'm flicking it out. This is where the beetle has been feeding and then depositing the frass behind it. And they start off kind of small. A lot of these tubes are kind of small, and then they get bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's typical of the Nautilus wood borer, which attacks California oaks. And this is a California coast live oak. Now this other one, we have another caller, and I'll go to the next caller here in a minute. But before we go on to the next caller, let's take a look at this. This is a piece of Engelmann oak that I collected out at Rancho Santa Ana. And I don't know if you can see it, but there are exit holes. Here's an exit hole right here from the beetles. Here, that's a big exit hole. And if you flip it over, you can see all the frass. Now this tree was completely dead when I went to see it. Here you see the holes much better. So now this tree is probably also infected with oak root rot fungus, but the drought, because this tree was getting irrigated about once a month out at Rancho Santa Ana Botanic Garden, but if you get root rot from oak root rot fungus, and it was an older tree, but this was also the nautical wood borer, but you can see all these exit holes, and this is what happens when you drought stress trees, so that's why you need to deep water them once a month. Now I see we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. And we have Jamie from the San Fernando Valley. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Go ahead with your question.
Just needed your ratio for boric acid, sugar, and water to control ants.
Okay. I use about a cup of sugar and 2 cups of water, warm water. That'll help dissolve it. And, of course, sugar is phenomenally soluble. You could probably even use more. But you want it to be very sweet and a little thicker. Not quite syrup, but you'll notice that, you know, when you use two cups of water and a cup of sugar, it's going to be a little thicker than just water. And then you want 1%, you want your solution to be 1% boric acid. And I use about a tablespoon to a cup of water. So I would use 2 tablespoons of boric acid. If you make it stronger than 1% boric acid, you'll kill the workers.
Right.
It'll be too toxic. And they'll drink it, and then they'll die. And that's not what you want to happen. You want them to collect it, and then take it back and share it with the whole colony. And you want them to feed on it over several weeks. And that will really, as they take it back and share it with the colony, they'll acquire a toxic dose of the boric acid. So you don't want it to be stronger than 1%. Some people use it as weak as 0.5%, but I found that just around 1% is just right. And for me, you know, I probably should go back and crunch the numbers a little bit, but that's about a tablespoon and a cup of water.
Okay. That'll work.
And then you got to keep it out, though. You got to find the trail of the Argentine ant, make your sugar water solution with a little boric acid, and then you put it in some kind of a container. Sometimes I make a little boat out of aluminum, and I set it right in the ant trail. And then they'll find it, and they'll start feeding on it. And you're going to have to replenish that over several weeks. And then you'll notice after about a week or two, they stop coming to it. That's because you're starting to affect the population. You'll never get rid of them all, though.
No, just a little control would be fine.
Yeah, you're trying to suppress them. Now put that outside. Don't put it in your house because you want to draw them outside of your house. If you have bait stations in your house, they learn to come in the house. The other thing is not to leave anything out in your kitchen or anywhere in the house that they'll feed on. So if you've got And they feed on sugars and meat or protein and carbohydrates. So if you just leave out, anything briefly, often they'll be all over it. So chicken bones or little bits of chicken or meat, Coca-Cola cans or fruit, watermelon. If you leave that stuff out on the countertop, even for an hour, they'll find it. So cleanliness is really important to keeping them out of the house. And then baiting them outdoors. And you can make your own bait solution with sugar water and boric acid. Don't make it stronger than 1%. Or you can buy a lot of different bait stations that they sell at various garden centers and hardwood stores, Osh, Home Depot, Lowe's, Armstrong, any garden center or nursery should carry some type of bait for Argentine ant. The other thing about Argentine ant is they do collect honeydew from sucking insects in your garden. So if you control your sucking insects, you'll also suppress the population of Argentine ant in your garden. So aphids, mealybug, scale, whitefly, if you can control those on the various shrubs in your garden, you'll also adversely affect the Argentine ant population because you'll starve them. And you'll probably kill them. If you're going to just spray your bushes with soapy water, then that will kill the aphids. And then the ants won't have any food, and that will affect their population. So now I have another video on sudden oak death. And since we're talking about oaks, we really need to talk about sudden oak death. Before we go to the video, let me just tell you a little bit about sudden oak death. I don't know if the video will get really in-depth. But in 1995, oaks started dying in large numbers, much higher than the normal mortality rate that you would have in an oak woodland up in the Bay Area. Marin County, Santa Cruz County, and a lot of the counties around San Francisco. It's up to 14 counties now where this is occurring. It started, what they noticed was that the oaks would start bleeding. They'd have a bleeding canker on the trunk. It would start dark, and the bark would check and crack, and then this black ooze would come out. Then very quickly, after these cankers appeared on the trees, they'd be attacked by different bark beetles. Ambrosia bark beetle, western oak bark beetle, and then suddenly the tree would just turn brown and die, usually in July, or with the first hot weather in the summer. And so they called it sudden oak death. Well, it really wasn't sudden. These cankers had been on the trunk for about 2, 3, 4, 5 years even. And the cankers get bigger and bigger and bigger and girdle the tree and kill it. And in 2000, it was diagnosed as being caused by a species of Phytophthora. Phytophthora is a water mold, and it was an undescribed species new to science. In 2001, it was published under the name Phytophthora ramorum, which means branch, because you would get these cankers on the trunks and also way up in the canopy on large scaffolds 30 feet off the ground. Very unusual for Phytophthora to have cankers that high in the canopy. It turned out that in addition to the oaks getting infected in the trunk and in the wood, it infects other plants as a leaf spot. And the California bay gets a leaf spot, and you get these lesions on the leaves. They make spores on the leaves. It rains and the wind blows. It splashes the spores onto an adjacent oak. The oaks get the cankers, and it kills the oak. It doesn't kill the bay. The bay still is infected in the leaves. There's a lot of leaf spot hosts, including all species of camellia, all species of rhododendron, of course, the California bay. It includes oleander, Magnolia grandiflora, a lot of natives, a toyon, some ceanothus species, a large group of plants that get the leaves infected. But let's go to this video on sudden oak death, because we're talking about oaks. We got the problem down in the Cleveland National Forest with the gold-spotted oak borer. Now we've had a problem since 95 up in the Bay Area on California coast live oak, not just coast live oak, but also all the black oaks, Shreve's oak, California black oak, California coast live oak, all the black oaks. So this disease called sudden oak death is a disease of black oaks, not white oaks or golden oaks, which is at least we can take a grain of hope from that, that we are not going to lose all our oaks. But we've got multiple threats to oaks in California, and this is one of the most important. Let's take a look at this video on sudden oak death.
Wow. This is my beautiful tree, Amy. I have lived in this house 34 years, and when I walked out the first time and saw the tree, I knew I had to buy the house. It's been my protector for 34 years, and now it's got sudden oak death.
In the 500 years since it first sprouted from a single acorn, this coast live oak tree outside Susan's house in West Marin County has endured a lot. Storms, drought, habitation by animals, and human encroachment. But the mighty oak may have finally met its match in a tiny organism called Phytophthora ramorum, which causes sudden oak death.
I don't know if I'm going to be able to save it. It's not looking real promising. It's not looking promising at all. You know, I said to my husband, I don't know if I can live in the house if it's gone. I can live in the house if it's gone. I cannot be here when they take it away.
P. ramorum is a fungus-like organism related to the one that caused the Irish potato famine of the 1840s. Once an oak is infected with the pathogen, the disease causes dramatic symptoms like bleeding cankers, brown leaves, and weakened limbs. Most trees die within 2 to 3 years.
Okay, so this is a clump of trees. They're all dead. Okay, they died recently. And then look at it here. The trail goes through what I call the tunnel of death. All these branches, all these trees are dead on top of the trail. I'm Matteo Garbellotto. I'm a forest pathologist at the University of California, Berkeley. A plant pathologist is a scientist who studies diseases of plants. Oh, this is beautiful. It's beautiful in its horror. I know sometimes we pathologists seem to think things are beautiful that are not really beautiful.
In 2000, Matteo Garbellato was recruited to join a group of scientists investigating the mysterious mortality of thousands of oak trees in California since the mid-1990s.
What are you seeing here?
Okay, what I see is healthy cambium here, and I see cambium that's being killed by Phytophthora ramorum. So all the brown area here is all colonized by the sudden death pathogen.
How does a tree work, and how does this disease affect the tree?
Well, you know, the cambium is the only part of the tree that's actually alive and capable of growing. So when Phytophthora ramorum kills the cambium, basically it makes it impossible for the tree to grow. And on top of that, this is the layer that's used by the tree to exchange nutrients from the crown into the roots. And then from the roots, they go back up into the crown using the outer part of the wood. So nutrients cannot go up from the roots into the leaves, and then carbohydrates, sugars cannot go from the leaves into the roots. And both these flows are necessary for a plant to grow.
In the last decade, well over 1 million oak and tan oak trees in 14 counties in California, from Humboldt to Monterey, have died, with more than 1 million more infected. Tan oak is a member of the beech family, but although it's technically not an oak, tan oak populations, like this one near Inverness, are some of the hardest hit.
If you were to count how many tan oaks are alive, you would be down maybe in the 10 percentile. So at least 90% of the tan oaks in this forest stand are infected, and as you can see, they're dying. So
the loss of oak and tan oaks may have dire ecological consequences, including soil erosion, increased fire risk, and loss of habitat for wildlife.
This is dead. I mean, at this point, you see.
Scientists still don't know how to stop the disease, but in recent years, they have found important clues. A major breakthrough for Matteo and his team came in 2001. They realized that the disease was being spread to oaks by other plants called host plants. These carriers, like Douglas fir, bay laurel, and redwood, often don't die, but they act as a breeding ground for the disease, whose spores can be spread by wind, rain, wildlife, and humans.
After about a year of research, we realized that it was not the oak that was giving the infection to the other oak, but it actually was the bay trees that were in the middle that were infecting the oaks in the area.
Oh yes, on the leaf tips here, huh?
And this is also how we think the disease was introduced here, you know, through a carrier host, not bay, but maybe an ornamental plant, and the infection would have looked like something like this, so not very conspicuous, and those plants were traded, sold, and this is how the infection arrived in California, most likely.
In 2006, Matteo and his colleagues published a genetic analysis of the sudden oak death pathogen. Their study provided new evidence that the commercial plant trade inadvertently introduced the microbe to the United States. And while its exact origin remains a mystery, research has confirmed that the pathogen can be spread to oaks and other wild plants by infected nursery plants. So far, more than 100 plant species have been found to be affected by P. ramorum, many of which are found in nurseries worldwide. Here in California, dozens of common nursery plants, like rhododendron and camellia, have been identified as carriers. It's a situation that's hit California's $3 billion nursery industry hard.
I've been working with the nurseries for about 18 years now. This is by far the largest problem like this that we have faced.
Within the nursery industry, which is the third largest agricultural business in California, the disease has become such a major concern that several U.S. states and foreign countries have imposed strict regulations regarding the commercial trading of host plants shipped from California. And nurseries have been forced to shoulder an additional expense: the widespread testing of their plants for the disease.
So sudden oak death still occurs up in the Bay Area. The farthest south it has come is Santa Cruz County. It's not in San Luis Obispo County. It's the closest infected tree is about 100 miles from the border of those two counties. It hasn't moved in a long time any farther south. So that appears to be the limits of the environmental, of a conducive environment. Early on, when this was all starting back in 2000 to about 2010, people were concerned that this would spread to the Sierras, it would spread to Southern California, but you really need a wet climate for sudden oak death to do well. The bay trees are the Typhoid Mary in this disease, the large California bay, Umbellifera californica. people started observing that for every, when you found an infected oak out in the oak woodland, right next to it was a bay. And the bays get are leaf spot hosts. They don't get the bark infected, so it doesn't kill them. And then on the surface of the leaf of the bay, it makes what are called chlamydospores and may make sporangia as well. When it rains in the spring and the wind blows, those spores splash off the leaf and onto the adjacent oak. Those spores infect the bark and start the cankers. The cankers get bigger and bigger and bigger and girdle the tree and kill it. So it's still a serious, serious problem up in the Bay Area, although Southern California, we found it in a lot of nursery production. I found it in a lot of nurseries. Starting in 2004, I collected positive samples at a nursery out in Azusa. Then in about 2005, I took over the whole program for the LA County Ag Commissioner. I was inspecting about 90 nurseries every winter to issue them what's called a compliance agreement that allowed them to ship their nursery stock out of state if we found that their nursery was clean and didn't have the disease. Then a lot of the nurseries cleaned up. The recession closed a lot of nurseries, unfortunately. And now a lot of the counties were regulated two ways. One, you were a quarantine county. That's the 14 counties where oaks are infected out in the woodlands. And then the rest are called regulated counties. At first, we were finding all the counties were finding a lot of infected plants in all these different nurseries. We were finding about 90% of the infected plants were on camellia. But then those nurseries either went out of business or they stopped growing camellias or they started doing things to prevent infection within their nurseries. And there's a lot of things you can do. So over the last, I'll say, 4 years, I didn't get any more positive nurseries. I had no positive nurseries. And that was happening in the other counties too. So they just recently rewrote the regs, and all of the nurseries in regulated counties, if they have not been positive in the last 2 years, are now exempt from being inspected. And so that's fine. We were spending a lot of money to go look for things in nurseries we weren't finding anymore. And there's only four nurseries outside of the quarantine counties in four different counties that are still part of that annual inspection program. So I don't have to go out to those nurseries anymore. I enjoyed going to those nurseries and meeting the people who run them, talking to them about their production and seeing what they're growing and talking to them about the other problems they have in production. Because after all, I'm a plant pathologist. I'm supposed to be interested in this. So that's that whole plant pathology, I mean, that whole sudden oak thing is what it's a real interesting story. Not only that, it's a real threat to our native oaks, but at least it's limited to the black oaks. It's not infecting the white oaks or the golden oaks. There are a number of other kinds of oaks we grow in Southern California that are not native. Let's take a look at a few of those. Let's look at the cork oak. This is a wonderful tree to grow if you want to grow. You know, you don't have to grow all natives. We can grow plants from around the world too. Let's take a look at our first picture of the cork oak. Now, this is the source of commercial cork. And bring this up full screen. As a mature tree, it's a big, beautiful tree. Nice central trunk. Getting to probably, you know, 40 feet here, or maybe even, bigger. They're not as big as some of our native oaks, like the California coast live oak, getting up to 50 or even 80 feet. Perhaps they'll get that big, but I haven't seen them that big. And let's take a look at the bark, number 28. It's got an incredibly thick, spongy bark. And bring this up full screen so you can get a good look at it. So that's what makes it so distinct, is this very thick bark that's all spongy in here. And when you harvest the, let's take a look at the acorns on the cork oak, which is our next picture. Here they are. This is the cork oak, very similar to the California coast live oak, but the cupula or the cap is a little more warty. And now let's take a look at the trunk. When they collect the oak, they literally, you can see this area down here, they've stripped all the bark off of there to use for cork. Now, most of the cork production is actually in Europe, and actually it's in Spain. And they had a big outbreak of a disease in Spain. I think it was Phytophthora cinnamomi, which causes a root rot. And just to digress briefly, Phytophthora is a genus. There are about 100 described species of Phytophthora. The name Phytophthora means the plant destroyer. The first described species was Phytophthora infestans, which causes late blight of potato. And that was actually the birth of plant pathology as a science. In 1845, potatoes started turning into mush. It was a blight. And for, you know, at the time, no one had a germ theory of disease. It wasn't until the later in the 1800s, about 1870, 1880, that a number of scientists started pointing out that these microscopic organisms that were just seen for the first time with the invention of the microscope were causing disease. That was a revelation. It was the germ theory of disease, that bacteria infect humans, get them sick, that viruses infect people and get them sick, that fungi can infect mostly plants and get them sick. We don't get there's very few fungal diseases of man. There are a few, but they're not made. There's not the major group of diseases. Bacteria and viruses are the major diseases of mammals. Fungi and viruses are the major group of diseases of plants. There are bacterial diseases too of plants, some very important ones. But as a group, fungi are the largest group of plant pathogens. So Phytophthora, there's about 100 species. Phytophthora infestans was the first one. Phytophthora cinnamomi has a huge host range. Now, most Phytophthoras cause root rot. So Phytophthora ramorum, which causes sudden oak death, is unique. It's a foliar pathogen and infects leaves on all these host plants other than oaks. On oaks, it infects the bark. So it's a bark disease really kills the vascular cambium. And then it kills the tree. So they had a big problem on cork oaks in Spain with Phytophthora cinnamomi. Now we have a couple other. Let's take a look at hollyoak. We only have a few minutes left. Let's take one more look at a few more. This is the hollyoak, Quercus ilex. Let's take a look at the acorns and leaves. This is not that big a tree, maybe 20 to 30 feet. I rarely see them getting any bigger than that. Let's take a look at the acorns and the leaves, which will be our next picture. And so here you see they have a kind of a elongated leaf with a smooth edge, no teeth, rather large conical acorn that is mostly out of the cap. And here's the cap. It's not very warty, not very bumpy. And here are the catkins from it. Let's take a look at our next picture. And here are more acorns, actually, and see if we have the catkins. But here are the catkins. Here are the catkins from the hollyoak. And here you can see those smooth-edged leaves right here. And so that's all the oaks we're going to talk about today. You could also take a look at, there are about 600 oaks. There's a lot of Mexican oak species that do quite well in California. We're running out of time. We had a lot of calls today, which is really great. I love to hear everyone calling in and sending us emails. I hope I've answered your questions. If you can't get, if you didn't get your answers today, you can contact me at my laboratory at the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. There's my email address, jturney@acwm.lacounty.gov. Send me an email. You can attach photographs. I want to thank our crew. Next door in the control room for all their hard work today helping to put on the show. They come in here on Sundays every week and they're doing their thing and that helps all you people learn more about the gardening and all their other wonderful shows they have on DHTV. So until next Sunday, I want to wish you happy gardening and get out and enjoy our wonderful Southern California weather.